Hello students, this is our second lecture on lattice vibrations and phonons. In this lecture we will be discussing about lattice vibrations in a one-dimensional monoatomic chain. Now in our introduction part to lattice vibrations and phonons, we had already mentioned the fact that atoms and molecules in a solid are in the state of vibrations about their mean lattice height. Now these atoms can either vibrate freely in its normal modes due to the internal energy of the system, or may be forced to vibrate under the action of an external force. These normal mode vibrations give information about the thermal properties of the solid, while if they are forced to move to vibrate under the action of an external force, these forced vibrations will give information about the acoustic and optical properties of the solid. As in a solid, all atoms are held together by or with the help of atomic bonds. We know that these bonds have a unique bond strength, bond length, which is the characteristic of a material. So any solid can be modeled as a three-dimensional network, periodic network of atoms, as shown here, connected by springs like this. The spring constant of each spring would be related to the bond strength, to the bond length, and to the bond order, which is nothing but unique for any material. So as an approximation, we can assume that these springs are massless and elastic. By saying elastic, I mean that the spring obeys Hooke's law. The stress generated in the spring is always linear to the strain generated in the spring. Stress is force per unit area, and assuming area remains constant, the spring force is always directly proportional to the extension in the spring and is thus directly proportional to the displacement of that. So as the force applied is directly proportional to the displacement of the atom, we can assume that atoms undergo simple harmonic motion. We also assume that the vibrations of these atoms, the amplitude of vibrations of these atoms, or the vibrational amplitudes, are much less compared to the separation between. With the increase in internal energy of the system, if the atoms starts vibrating with an amplitude greater than or equal to the interatomic spacing between the atoms, then they have sufficient energy to break the bonds and get freed away. In that case, a solid gets converted into a liquid. Now, since the atoms are connected by elastic springs, the vibration of a single atom is shared by all other neighboring atoms, and hence a solid executes coupled vibrations. This is a very important point to remember. A solid executes coupled vibrations. A solid execute coupled vibrations. The simple harmonic vibrations of each atom generate a wave, and they similarly, all other atoms will generate independent waves. These waves superimpose with each other and form a group of waves which finally traverse through the solid. So corresponding to these lattice vibrations, we will be having phase velocity of the waves due to individual vibrations of the atoms, as well as a group velocity of a group of waves, and the actual energy transfer from one end to the another end of a solid is through the velocity of the group. Now, in order to investigate what frequency spectrum, we are interested in finding out the frequency spectrum for the waves of the waves propagating through a solid, and how that frequency spectrum depends on the elastic properties of the solid. So in order to get any information about the frequency spectrum of such waves, we need to solve the harmonic oscillator problem for coupled oscillator. Now, as you can see, in case of solid, you have infinite number of atoms connected among themselves with springs. So it is practically impossible to solve a harmonic oscillator problem for such a big coupled oscillator system. So, since in a solid, atoms are arranged periodically in a lattice, so to a fair approximation, we can restrict our problem to the motion of one atom coupled with its nearest neighbors. For this case, it would be like this. One atom, since the solid we have discussed here is a simple cubic solid, so any atom in this solid will be shared by six nearest neighbors. So we can reduce our problem to a three-dimensional coupled oscillator. But to start with, a three-dimensional coupled oscillator is also very complicated, and we will be lost in the calculations related to this three-dimensional coupled oscillator and will lose focus on the exact problem, because any stretching in this central atom will be followed by bending and stretching in the subsequent springs. So the problem will be very complicated. In order to avoid such a situation, we consider a one-dimensional solid like this. Here the atoms are all arranged along one line and they are connected together by these springs. So in order to understand the impact of elastic properties of solid on the waves propagating through it, we consider a simplest case and we restrict our problem to a one-dimensional chain of atoms. Let the chain be oriented along x direction. What will be the equilibrium state for such a configuration? When all the atoms are separated by equal distance, and that distance is the lattice parameter. Such an arrangement constitutes an inhomogeneous arrangement because the mass is not uniformly distributed along the chain. Now you can imagine, for such a linear arrangement, one unit would be one atom followed by its spring. The length of this unit would be, let's say, A. Then the entire mass of this unit is concentrated at one end of the, at its one end where the atom is attached. For the rest of the length, there is no mass. So the mass per unit length along the unit is non-uniform. So such an arrangement is called inhomogeneous arrangement. A homogeneous case would be when the mass is equally distributed all along the chain. This would have been possible by removing the springs. If we remove the springs and place the atoms side by side, just like this, as if they touch each other, in that case, the atoms form a continuous line lying side by side and touch each other. So the mass is more or less uniformly or equally distributed all along the chain, at least beyond atomic dimensions. But this is not a practical case. So this particular arrangement is called a homogeneous arrangement. Since solids are not homogeneous chain of atoms, what impact does it have on the dispersion properties of the solid in relation to that it would have if the solid were a homogeneous chain of atoms? But before dealing with this problem, we will first understand what do you mean by dispersion relation and what is its form in case of a homogeneous system. Dispersion relation is the relationship between the frequency and the wavelength of a wave in a medium, or we can say it is the relationship between the angular frequency and the wave vector or wave number associated with a wave in a medium, like this. In our context, what we want to know, how the wavelength or how the frequency, angular frequency of vibrations, lattice vibrations within a solid is affected by the wavelength or the wave vector of the waves. So we want to find the nature of the curve between omega and k. Now, if we consider the case of a homogeneous arrangement, due to this homogeneous nature, any impact on one of the atom will be transferred completely to the other without any restoring event in between. So the vibrations of all the atoms are either in phase or will have a fixed phase relation among one another. So what we want to say is, as a result of which, these vibrations, independent vibrations, will add up, will superimpose, resulting in a group or modulated wave which will have the same frequency and wave number as that of the individuals. We can represent the velocity of independent waves as by Vp, which is the phase velocity, and we know phase velocity is omega by k. And the velocity of the group of waves by group velocity Vg, which is d omega by dk. In case of homogeneous arrangement, this phase velocity, or the velocity with which the independent waves propagate, and the velocity with which the group of waves propagate, both are same. That would be possible only in case when omega versus k is linear, like this. So this means that irrespective of the value of omega and k, the velocity of waves through this homogeneous arrangement is constant. So all waves, irrespective of the frequency, will travel with the same velocity in the solid. Now, if the velocity of the wave in a medium is constant, irrespective of its wavelength or wave number, then the refractive index of the solid is a constant, is not a function of the wave. Such a medium is called a non-dispersive medium. Air is an example of a non-dispersive medium. A light traveling through air does not disperse into its independent, into various wavelengths. We want to know whether a solid being an inhomogeneous medium is also non-dispersive or dispersive. If it is dispersive, then what kind of relation does wave vectors have with the wave frequency within the solid? Let us now set up our system of a one-dimensional monoatomic solid. A one-dimensional monoatomic solid can be represented like this: an infinite chain, linear chain of atoms. We assume this linear chain of atom is oriented along x direction. Each atom has a mass m and is separated with its nearest neighbor by a distance a. That is, the interatomic distance is a. Considering the zeroth atom to be at the origin, the x coordinate of the nth atom would be na. Similarly, the x coordinate of n minus 1th atom would be n minus 1a, of n plus 1th atom would be n plus 1a. What are the questions need to be answered? First, what is the dispersion relation based on this spring ball arrangement of a monoatomic chain of solid? Second, what is the velocity of the lattice waves propagating through the solid? How the velocity of lattice wave depends on the elastic properties of the solid? What are the range of frequencies or the frequency spectrum of the lattice waves propagating through a solid? And how this range depends on the elastic properties of the solid? We need to answer these questions, and the subsequent description, through this subsequent description, we will be able to answer all these questions. under equilibrium condition, all the atoms will be separated by will be separated equally by an interatomic distance, what is called A. Each atom undergoes a simple harmonic motion. We assume that these atoms are executing simple harmonic motion about their mean positions along x-axis. That means we are restricting our problem only to longitudinal vibrations. These atoms can also vibrate perpendicular to the direction of chain. That would lead to transverse vibrations. But in order to we are restricting our problem to longitudinal vibrations only. So we are trying to find out what kind of waves are being generated due to these longitudinal vibrations within a solid, within this linear monoatomic solid. Let us at any instant of time we take a snapshot, and the relative positions of all the atoms are recorded like this in the lower chain. The n minus 1th, let the n minus 1th atom gets displaced by an amount un minus 1 about its equilibrium position. The nth atom gets displaced by an amount un about its equilibrium position. And the n plus 1th atom gets displaced by an amount un plus 1 from its equilibrium position. In analogy to what we had discussed for the three-dimensional case, here also we restrict our problem only to the simple harmonic motion of one atom coupled with its nearest neighbors. So let us consider that atom as the nth atom. It can be seen that the nth atom is connected to its nearest neighbors n minus 1 to the left and n plus 1 to the right by two springs on two sides. So obviously any kind of displacement towards the left or towards the right will generate an opposite forces, and the net force acting on un will be the force generated due to the right spring minus the force generated due to the left spring, or vice versa. So if u is the compression or elongation in the spring with a spring constant beta, we assume that these springs have a spring constant beta, then due to that compression or extension, a force will be generated, a spring force, which is equal to minus beta u. Pertaining to the above discussion, we could get the expression for force acting on the nth atom as this, where the first term is the spring force due to the relative displacement of the n plus 1th atom compared to nth atom, and the second term is the spring force generated due to the relative displacement of the n minus 1th atom relative to the nth atom. Since both the forces are opposing each other, so we put a negative sign over here. This negative makes the expression positive, so we can write it this way. We play with the expressions a bit more. We can come down to this expression applying Newton's second law of motion, where we can write F to be m d square un by dt square. This is a linear second order differential equation and has plane wave solutions. So the plane wave solution for this equation would be this, where u naught is the amplitude of oscillation, omega is the frequency, angular frequency of oscillation, and xn is the equilibrium position coordinate, x coordinate of that particular nth atom. We know xn is na, so we can write this expression as this. We can look for similar solutions for n minus 1th atom and n plus 1th atom like this. So we will use these solutions of un, un minus 1, un plus 1 in this expression. But first we should know what is the expression for d square un by dt square. For that we have to doubly differentiate our expression for un. So when we differentiate it for first time, we will get this expression. On differentiating it second time with respect to time, we get it equal to minus omega square un. So we replace all the terms un, un plus 1, un minus 1 with their respective expressions, and that force equation takes the form like this. We can take u naught e to the power I omega t minus ka common, which is nothing but un. Taking that to common, we can write the expression like this. we can equate the coefficients of u n on both sides. The equation takes the form this. Working on with this term, bracketed term, we can write the bracketed term like this. This is of the form e to the power I theta minus e to the power minus I theta. It can be written in terms of sine theta, because sine theta is e to the power I theta minus e to the power minus I theta by 2i. Writing it in terms of sine theta, we can write it in this form, where theta is k a by 2. And there will be a 4 sine, because in the denominator there should be a 2 while converting it in form of sine. And minus, because I square comes out to be minus. Cancelling this minus sign on both sides, we get an expression for omega square as this. So omega will be a square root of this expression, and it will be plus and minus. But frequency is always positive irrespective of the sign of k, so we ignore the negative sign. And what we get is a relation between omega and k, and this is the relation which is called the dispersion relation for a linear monoatomic solid. It can be seen that omega is not linearly related to k, rather it is a periodic function of k. It has a maxima under root 4 beta by m, where beta is the spring constant which is related to the elastic properties of the solid. We will stop here, and we will continue our discussion by plotting this omega as a function of k in our next lecture. Thank you.